Thank you for the invitation. It's nice to have a neuronet and an umbrella for all neurodegenerative projects in the field of IMI funding, because we definitely can benefit from interacting with each other. So I will give a presentation on EMIF, in particular the Alzheimer part. So EMIF is the acronym for European Medical Information Framework, and the aim of EMIF was to provide better access to existing data to do research, and in our case on Alzheimer's disease. Just to set a framework of the research we did in EMIF related to Alzheimer's disease, this is the a model for the development of Alzheimer's disease, starting with amyloid plaques, followed by tau tangles, atrophy, and dementia. And this is a long process, so each of these steps takes around 5 years or more. And in the early stage of the disease, there are no cognitive impairments, and that slowly evaluates. You start with the plaques in your brain without any memory impairments and complaints. Later on, if there's more damage and more atrophy, you get mild cognitive impairment, and at the end you get dementia. So it's important to realize that dementia is really the end stage of a long disease process and not the start of Alzheimer's disease. So because there's little known about these very early stages of the disease, the focus of EMIF-AD was on better understand the duration, the prevalence of the disease, and risk factors for progression. And with keeping in mind that treatment should be given rather in this stage and not in the stage when somebody is severely demented. So EMIF stopped last year. It was a 5-year project with a 6-month extension, and our aims were to increase the understanding of the early pathophysiology of Alzheimer's disease, so we call that pre-dementia Alzheimer's disease, and discover biomarkers and risk factors, and by means of also building a access way for use of existing data. So I give some examples of that. So we had research and we had the infrastructural part of EMIF. So EMIF AD was part of big project EMIF, sorry. And the vision was to provide better access to existing data. We had 3 sub-projects, EMIF platform on the access to electronic health registry data. I will give some data on that in my next talk after the lunch. EMIF metabolic on diabetes and EMIF AD. And from now on, I will only talk about EMIF AD. And these are the partners in all the projects together. I think it's one of the biggest IMI projects we had. That advantages, disadvantages. So as regarding the infrastructure, so we developed a catalog with metadata of cohorts to find the data we would need for our research. And we developed the EMIF-AD Transmart data platform to store the new data we generated as part of our research. So this is an example of the registry. So it lists cohorts on aging and neurodegeneration. So if, for example, active care is a project in Maastricht University run on care models. So you find more information on that project if you click on active care. So and you can search the database of registers. So we have here a number of search fields. So if you would like to search for studies that have data on caregiver burden or quality of life or no psychiatric symptoms, you can click those fields and you get back a list of cohorts that have collected those data. And then you can invite them for collaborative projects and to pool data. So the emphasis on the projects included in the catalog was on Alzheimer's disease, because we were EMIF-AD and in the early stage, so we have not so many studies on this, but everybody can use this catalog and add their own studies. And and build collaborations. So we have 500 people who has been registered to the catalog and do searches, and we have over 60 cohorts with data listed there. So that's one asset, so to say. The other asset is the data platform. So we developed within the Transmart environment a database to store data from different cohorts in a harmonized way. So we harmonized all the data. And we also stored the data we generated as part of EMIF. So we have proteomic data, genomic data, imaging data, all on Transmart. Now I will show some data on the research we did. So we did a pooled analysis of 50 cohorts worldwide to establish the prevalence of amyloid pathology in cognitively normal individuals or non-demented individuals. So we had a big data. We developed a big database of around 3,000 participants who had normal cognition, those with subjective complaints and MCI. And you can see that the prevalence of amyloid pathology increases with age in those individuals. So the gray line are cognitively normal individuals. So at age 90, around 40% of the cognitively normal individuals have some degree of amyloid pathology in their brain. You can see that those with subjective complaint have not really a higher prevalence of amyloid pathology, but those with MCI, they have. So at age 90, 80% of those with mild cognitive impairment indeed have amyloid pathology in the brain. So this gives some idea on what you can expect from the disease and the prevalence. And we compare those curves also with the prevalence of AD type dementia in the general population. So this is the increase in amyloid pathology in cognitively normal individuals. And this is the prevalence of AD type dementia. So you see a parallel line, which suggests that there is a 20-year interval between the onset of amyloid pathology and the start of dementia. But of course, this is interference. But we did another study to get a better estimate of this duration. So what we did, we linked cohorts, six cohorts, existing cohorts, used their data with data on preclinical Alzheimer's disease, so cognitively normal amyloid, prodromal AD, MCI and amyloid, mild AD dementia, moderate dementia. And we modeled the follow-up data into a common model, taking into account age. And this is what we found. So the different colors here are different stages, and this is the start age. So if we take somebody with preclinical Alzheimer's disease at age 60, the total duration of the disease is 24 years, according to this modeling. So the first 15 years or something are in the preclinical stage, then there's another 5 years of prodromal AD and another 3 years of mild to moderate dementia. If you start at age 70, all those phases are a bit shorter, and it becomes also because mortality becomes a competing risk for getting dementia. And at age, so the duration is 18 years. And if you start with preclinical AD at age 80, you have 15 years left until you die. Okay, so we set up some new cohorts using existing cohorts, actually. So we enriched the Dutch twin registry with AD biomarkers, such that we could investigate the role of genetics and environmental factor on the development of Alzheimer biomarkers. So we included 100 monozygotic twin pairs. So they are, as you can see, genetically identical, and they share a lot of features, also their clothes. And then we took an amyloid PET scan, and so around 70% of the pairs, they were cognitively normal, or in 6 years were amyloid negative on the PET scan. Six were concordant amyloid positive, and around 20 pairs, they showed a difference. So one of the pairs was amyloid positive, the other was amyloid negative. If you analyze the differences within those twin pairs, we found a correlation of around 55%, which means that the similarity of those amyloid build-up is for maximal 55% explained by genetic factors, which are shared. And the difference, so the 45%, can be attributed to unique environmental factors that differ between the twins from a twin pair. And there are also twin studies on the concordance in dementia, clinical AD type dementia, and then we get a much higher number. So 70% of the onset of dementia, Alzheimer type dementia, is attributed to genetic factors. So we expect that later on the concordance rate between the twins in amyloid aggregation will become more similar within the pairs. So that the start of the amyloid aggregation is determined by environmental factors. And later on, at the end, they will develop both amyloid pathology. So, and we have now follow-up ongoing in those twins as part of the IMIPET project, another IMI project. So we did studies on white metalesia, hippocampal atrophy, all the OAD biomarkers. Okay, we set up another enriched cohort of nonagenarians, so to find predictive or risk factors for cognitive impairment in the oldest old. So we had 120 participants, 80 were cognitively normal, and 40 had MCI or dementia, and we did all the PET scans, MR scans and others, and compared them. And what we found as the strongest marker of a good memory function at old age actually was physical activity, or sorry, the head grip strength or physical performance test. So you see the degree of memory impairment in red, these are cognitively impaired, and the degree of memory impairment in the cognitively normal. So there's a huge difference. Actually, the biggest difference we saw for all the markers, vascular markers, nutrition markers, inflammation markers, the biggest difference we found for this physical activity. And the physical activity also correlated strongly with hippocampal atrophy. So the more physical activity, the bigger the hippocampus. So we cannot draw any causal conclusions about it, but well, it fits with some of the literature that physical activity stimulates brain plasticity. Then we performed a biomarker discovery study. And here we used existing samples and scans and clinical data in databases and biobanks across Europe. And we aim to find diagnostic and prognostic markers and better understand the pathophysiology. So we included over 1,000 individuals from existing cohorts. So in Amsterdam, Antwerp, Lausanne, San Sebastian, and another multicenter studies in Europe. I will not show a lot of the data, only the efforts it took us to collate the data. So we collected scans for volumetry, CSF samples for targeted, untargeted proteomics, plasma, proteomics and metabolomics, and GWAS exome sequencing, DNA methylation. So we performed one of the biggest CSF proteomics studies of 400 participants, plasma proteomics up to 800 in existing data. I will show some of the data. What we found is that fatty acids correlated here with cognitive measures in metabolomics in plasma, and amino acids in particular with CSF biomarkers and cognition. So, and the whole process to collect those samples took around 3 years, and the longest phase to get the in that process was to get contract signed with each of the sites. So we searched 1.5 years. Using the catalog, then people had to sign data transfers, and that took most of the time. Harmonization was 6 months, data analysis was another 10 months. So, but it's worthwhile because you get very big data sets after that. And this is the last data slide we generated. So we clustered CSF proteins from individuals with amyloid pathology, so it totaled something like 300. And we found three subgroups within the AD spectrum. And this is how the protein profiles differed between the groups. So one group of proteins increased in subtype with increased plasticity proteins here, which were decreased in the other subtype. A group of proteins associated with inflammation increased in subtype 2 and decreased in the other subtype. And a group of blood-brain barrier proteins increased in the third group and decreased in the other two groups. So we showed subgroups within Alzheimer's disease in this 1,000 IMIF-AD multi-biomarker discovery study. So this is the team of the IMIF-AD part, organized by work package. We had a close interaction between pharma and the academic sites. They really provided useful input to the FPI partners in the project. And we collaborated with the external cohort outside IMIF for their data. I would like to thank also the partners from IMIF in general, in particular the leads of IMIF, Bart and Simon Lofstone, and colleagues from the EMIF platform who helped us to set up the catalog in Transmart Instant. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Pieter. So what I was wondering, as one of the partners in Neuronet, because EMIF project's now finished, can you say a bit about the kind of the strategy for taking some of the work forward, like the catalogue is still available, for example, and is there anything that you think that Neuronet could help facilitate in making sure that some of the learnings coming out of EMIF are kind of captured by some of the other projects?
Yes, so we have the infrastructures like the catalog, so it more or less stepped over to another IMI project, the support from that to Eden, but at some point that will end, and the same for the Transmart data platform. And we have obtained some funding from the FPR partners to extend the catalog and the Transmart instance, and also to align that with the DPUK data sharing infrastructure. So we will work on that, and our ambition is to make one European portal for data in Europe. Any help with that and background support for maintaining those infrastructures would be very useful, because it's like the previous speaker said, it's not exciting science, but it's important to facilitate studies. The other asset is the data we generated, the 1,000 cohort data, proteomic data, and the twin data. We get on a regular basis requests for data, and it would be nice if we get rid of the logistics involved in that. So there's a request coming in, we give it to Neuronet, and they ask for a proposal, interact with the partners that provided the data, try to set up an MTA for that, and we say yes at the end of the whole process. So a broker for the data we collected. The other thing, we are being asked on a regular basis to searches in the catalog to provide a set of cohorts for studies. So that could be also performed by Neuronet.